Supervision is very important word here. And if you'll look, and this comes from the definition of nursing practice law, supervision is a close watch involving judicious oversight and evaluation and the provision of guidance and direction. So whether you're supervising a nursing student, supervising another staff member, supervising anyone, this is what supervision means in the eyes of the nursing practice law. So it says a close watch involving judicious oversight. So there's a lot of strong words in here. Dealing with your judgment, watching closely, evaluating, and providing guidance and direction. Approved program of nursing is the nursing program which has been officially recognized as having met the standards set forth by the legally authorized approval or accrediting entity within the state. And all of the recognized schools of nursing in this state are accredited by the state, and your registered nursing programs and higher degrees by a national accrediting body. It's in our rules and regulations of the state. So all the schools that are, you know, listed and legit and all are, do have proper accreditation. Types of supervision. There's two types that the nursing practice law speaks of. First one is direct supervision, and this is supervision provided by an individual who is physically present in the patient care unit where the patient is receiving care. So when it says these must be directly supervised, that's what that means. Indirect supervision, supervision provided by an individual who is immediately accessible but is not physically present on the patient care unit where the patient is receiving nursing care. So that would be someone who may be in-house, but is not directly on that unit. But anything that requires direct supervision, the person has to be, in fact, physically present on the unit. I know with our transition unit at Hines, we used to use more of a preceptive experience till we couldn't get enough preceptors. But anyway, now the faculty have a lot of that. But anyway, the preceptive experiences, we told our students, you even have to go to lunch when they go to lunch. In other words, you don't have to eat lunch with them if they, you know, need a break or you need a break or whatever. But everybody has to be off the unit at the same time. So that was very important that we made sure that the students and staff understood, you know, exactly what that meant there. Policies, procedures, and our guidelines of your clinical agencies. You have to be familiar with the policies and procedures at your agency. And you have to abide by those. If you are functioning in a role and you are abiding by the policies and procedures of your agency will assume accountability and responsibility as the direct charge of those procedures. Okay? Where we get into trouble is when we step outside of what our agency's policies and procedures and guidelines say. So you need to be very familiar with those, and I'm sure had orientation of those when you were hired, and are very up to date on what those policies and procedures are. There may be additional activities or skills identified by the individual agency that students are not allowed to engage in or perform. And you need to know what those are. It doesn't matter what the School of Nursing will allow them to do. If your agency does not allow that to occur, then they don't need to do it in your agency. Does that make sense to y'all? Most of the time, those walk hand in hand in terms of what students can and cannot do. But if it is something your agency does not allow students to do, then they do not need to do it, no matter what the School of Nursing says. So you need to kind of be the gatekeeper with that, too. Refer to policy and procedure manuals, and also your hospital education department is a real good resource for you with that, because they're very familiar with these policies and procedures that are in place. Any questions on that? Policies, procedures, and our guidelines of schools of nursing. Each school of nursing should provide in writing guidelines related to those activities students can and or cannot perform. So as you're working with schools of nursing, you need to be very familiar with what their rules say that a student can and cannot do. Also, you need to keep in mind that the students have the same form. They know or should know what they can and cannot do also. should also address the amount and type of supervision required. I know at Hines, we have a sheet called Guidelines for Student Supervision. It's based on whatever level that student is, and it says, you know, the nurse shall always accompany a student with this, or the faculty shall always be present when a student is doing this. And a lot of our procedures come from practice because we know that a lot of hospitals require, you know, direct supervision of students doing certain procedures and things. So we kind of got together, because we go to just about every hospital that will let us in the door for sure with our numbers, and look at those and kind of got a consensus of what, and we always are going to go with, and I'm sure university does the same thing, and most of the schools around, go with the thing, if it's not allowed at one agency, many times we'll take it off the student list because of the confusion, you know, with so many different schools and nurses and that type of thing. However, see the DU, that's another benefit, may open up some opportunities that are specific to that hospital that they will allow that other places won't. So that's another positive thing that could result from those. These will be based on the level of student and prior experiences. Clinical affiliation agreement between clinical agencies and schools of nursing outlines the agreement between the parties as to who provides and is responsible for identified needs. And all of your agencies have these clinical affiliation agreements with schools of nursing. And it states in there, the agency will, the school will, the student will. All of that's very, very much outlined. These go through the legal departments of all the agencies and schools. So it's a legal document, binding agreement. Responsibility of the administration and our management of the school and the clinical agency. So this is not something that you have to make sure is there. The agency itself has already ensured that. Usually required by all accrediting bodies. The Joint Commission requires these to be in place if students are in the facility. CCNE and NLNAC, which are two of the accrediting bodies that accredit schools of nursing, require that these be there. Hines just had the opportunity to undergo reaccreditation process with NLNAC, which is similar to y'all's Joint Commission coming through. And they pulled our clinical affiliation book of all our agency contracts and checked a list of where we said we went to clinical against to make sure we had a clinical affiliation agreement there. In fact, the person who did that was actually a clinical person. NLNAC has a clinical person who travels with their accrediting body. And her hospital had just received magnet status. So she called those very well. She knew exactly what she was looking for. So anyway, and I'm proud to report they were all in order. So our book was probably nothing. The key word in everything here is supervision. And that's just the key. Anytime you're dealing with anybody, student, another nurse, nursing assistant, you know, and those university medical students or whoever's involved, you know, the main thing is everything is the supervision word there. You must know who to supervise when you're dealing with students, the level of the student, and your faculty coordinator will help with that and help identify that. What to supervise, what are the specific activities that must be supervised at all times. When to supervise, do I have to supervise them all the time or just at certain times? Sometimes the procedure or the policies or guidelines will say the first time a student does the skill, they must be supervised. Then after that, they can have independent function if you decide to let them. And in the case of faculty, it's if they decide to let them go. In other words, if I look at a student do something and they did fine that time, it's a skill maybe they had the semester before, and I felt comfortable with letting them go to do it after that on their own, then that's okay according to our procedures and guidelines. But if they didn't, I don't care how many times people had let them go, if they were with me and I didn't feel comfortable with that, I watched them. So you have that discretion in there to do what you think is best. Because ultimate responsibility, as Pat says, lies with safety of the patient and making sure we provide safe care. And we have that charge as an RN. Teacher, no teacher, faculty, no faculty. That's just what we do. And then how to supervise, direct supervision or indirect supervision. All parties have agreed on the following as being clinical skills that may not be performed by students assigned to clinical rotations on DEU units. And those of you who have worked with the summer extern program, these are the same things that the externs cannot do. We felt like when we're in the initial phases of this grant that it was best to keep those lists as similar as possible so as not to have a lot of confusion there. So everyone at the table, which were your agency representatives in the schools of nursing involved in the grant, this is the agreed upon list, you know, that they may not do. And that's hang lipids, hyperal, chemo, rejection meds, epidurals, and our experimental drugs, titrate IV medications, and I'm just going to run through these quickly because they're on the handout too. May not administer or restart blood products, may not withdraw blood from central or arterial lines, discontinue PIC or central IV lines, conduct cardiac outputs and manipulate arterial and or invasive monitoring lines, including removal of catheter, access controlled medications, remove or hang narcotics for PCA pumps, carry the narcotic keys or count narcotics, access dialysis devices and or implantable cords, manipulate peritoneal dialysis, tape, extubate, or manipulate endotracheal tubes, manipulate respiratory ventilator equipment, auto-infusion devices, and or dialysis, discontinue chest tubes, or perform vaginal exams. And this list, as I said earlier, is the same as those skills that student nurse externs may not perform. Now, as we're working through the grant and the DEU units, we get more familiar with those and working with staff and all that. This list may be reevaluated when we have put that in the plan, that we will come back to the table and kind of reassess the list and see how this is working. But today, this is the current list of what students may not do, regardless of situation.